But you can influence your future. And so we know also in this house that life does not depend on what has happened or is happening to us, but what we choose to do about what is happening or what has happened to us. We know also from past teachings that when we make our choices in turn make us, and we become the servants of the choices that we make. In Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10, Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10, the Bible says, "We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." This verse of the Bible tells us that God has foreordained certain good things to happen in our lives before we were born. But the fact that God has predestined or foreordained those things to happen does not necessarily mean that they will just automatically happen. You will always have a part to play. You must always get involved. And the way you get involved in activating those things is through your choices. So that with your choices and decisions, you get involved. Either to activate what God has planned for you, or to hinder the manifestation of those things that God has in stock for you. And so the choices that you make will either release the things that God has prepared for you, or will hinder the release of those things that God has prepared for you. And that's why I said earlier that you are the only one that can stop yourself. The devil is too small to stop you if you cooperate with God. But you are the one that can stop yourself, because what you will, God will not disallow. Whatever you allow, God will not disallow. It is what you disallow. You know, the Bible says, when you bind, then it is bound in heaven. When you loose, then it is loosed in heaven. And so it depends on you. It is what you allow that God allows. What you disallow, God disallows it. And so if you allow something, God will not disallow it. That's why the topic is choose to be proactive. And what does it mean to be proactive? To be proactive is to create or control a situation by causing something to happen. To be proactive is to identify and prevent potential problems. To be proactive is to be enterprising. To be proactive is to take charge, to take initiative, and take responsibility. To be proactive is to respond to situations instead of reacting to situations. They are two different things. You can either respond to a situation or you react to a situation. Now, what does it mean to react to a situation? What it means is to act reciprocally upon the situation, upon someone, or upon the matter. What that means is to duplicate the conduct. To react, for instance, if someone slaps you and you slap them back, you have duplicated the conduct and you have reacted. Does that make it clear? So to react also is to act in a reverse directional manner, or to return to a prior condition, to withdraw. And so to react can be to duplicate the conduct. To react also can be to withdraw and enter into a cave. Someone slaps you, you withdraw from the person. I'm done. That's also a reaction. That is not a response, it's a reaction. Now, to react also can be to act in opposition as against some force. And so to react, number one, is to duplicate the conduct. To react, number two, can be to withdraw. To react, number three, can be to act in opposition. And that's when it says, you know, the chicken has spilled your medication, you want to kill the chicken. You are reacting, isn't it? You are acting in opposition with even a greater level of force than the original one. And so that's reaction. Now, what does it mean to respond? What it means to respond is to act in answer to something. It means to act in answer, to act with solution. That's responding. It involves the ability to carefully listen to people in a non-judgmental manner, to clarify specific disputes and to offer suggestions for reaching an equitable compromise. So responding is to act. Is to act in an answer to something. Is to act with a solution to something. You are not duplicating the conduct. You are not withdrawing. You are not acting with a greater force, but you are responding with a solution. And that involves the ability to analyze the situation and to now come up with suggestions that can facilitate an equitable compromise. That is responding. And so responding to issues and people build relationships of trust, respect, and productive interactions. And they also help us to develop good problem-solving abilities. I'm sure there's a story that you probably have heard several times, or maybe you have heard before, of when the English people, when they were in India. You know, England colonized in there, and they wanted in Calcutta, in a place, to set up a golf course. And in that area, there were many monkeys there. And so, a golf course, they had their fence there. But monkeys will always come. Every time the ball is played, before it is played a second time, a monkey will have shifted the position of the ball. And that affected the game a great deal. And they began to think. Their first instinct was to react. Their first reaction was to erect a very high fence, as high as possible, to prevent the monkeys from interfering with the game, to prevent the monkeys from shifting the position of the ball. But they very quickly realized that monkeys can climb. And so though the fence was very high, the monkeys were able to climb. And that was not a solution. And so they thought, what else? How can we lure the monkeys away? And somebody maybe they thought, now let's get some bananas. As we throw the bananas away from the court, it will keep the monkeys busy. But they didn't realize that monkeys like bananas so well that though there were few monkeys originally, several other monkeys showed up. Originally, they were contending with perhaps 10. Now that bananas were introduced, 20 other monkeys showed up. And so that did not solve the problem. And then they now sat down to analyze the situation, to now respond to the situation with a solution. And then they now said, in Calcutta, India, this golf is going to be played in such a manner. They added to the rule that additional rule will be that wherever the monkey drops the ball is where you will play it from. And so if you hit the ball and it lands right here, and the monkey picks it from here and drops it here, when you are playing the second round, you will hit the ball from where the monkey dropped it. And so it became part of the rule, and life became very easy. That was it. So they were no longer bothered by what the monkeys were doing, by the pressures of the monkey. Brethren, one of the great teachings in spiritual life is that it does not matter what is happening. What matters is how we respond. How we respond is what determines our happiness. How you respond is what determines your peace of mind. So can you think of a place in your life where things are not cooperating with how you would like them to be? What unfortunate place the monkeys have dropped a ball in your life? Bring your focus to that. It could be something that happens in a relationship with another person where you get reactive. What will it mean to play the ball from here? And if you could tap into your deepest wisdom, your true compassion, you will like to respond. You will like how you would like to respond to the circumstances. God wants you not to react, but to respond with solution. Because your happiness is not determined by what happens to you. It's determined by how you respond. Because someone can slap you now and just put a smile on and say, God bless you. And the person will even feel worse than you. the person immediately will feel will feel guilty for doing what the person has done. And the person can slap you, and you slap the person back, and the person carries you, hits you on the ground, boom, you are gone. Back broken. Is it not possible? And so if back gets broken, then you say, oh, is this person who slapped me that caused it? No. It's the way you reacted. Otherwise, the person probably will have just slapped you and walk away. But the fact that he slapped you and you slapped back made him carry you and hit you on the rock. Proactive and reactive people. The proactive recognize that their responsibility. A proactive person recognizes his or her responsibility, takes initiative, make things happen. Whereas a reactive person is unwilling to accept responsibility. As far as the reactive person is concerned, it is everybody's fault. It is never his or her fault. The proactive are driven by values. They are driven by principles and character. Their attitude, behavior, and performance are based on values. They respond to external circumstances based on character. Whereas the reactive, they are driven by their feelings. They are driven by circumstances. They are driven by conditions and conditioning. Their environment affects their attitude, affects their behavior and their performance, because they react to the physical environment. If the weather is good, they feel good. If the social environment is good, when people treat them well, then they feel well. That's when they feel well. When people don't treat them well, they feel very sick. They don't feel well because they react to the social environment. They build their emotional lives around the behavior of others. What a tragedy, or a jeopardy. What a disaster for someone to build his or her emotional life around the behavior of some other people. Of course, they turn you into a yo-yo. Because when the environment is not right, you are wrong too. You are not right. They empower the weakness of others to control them. You know, in Genesis, you know the story of Adam and Eve. How the first man was very reactive. The man was standing by. The devil came speaking to his wife, and he was looking. Do you know we have that situation right now? It was not just then that we find the man looking and not saying anything while the devil is interacting with the wife. The devil was interacting with Eve. Adam was standing by. And after Eve was cornered, the Bible now tells us that Eve gave the same thing to Adam. And the man ate. And when God now showed up, he said, "Is that woman you gave me?" That was a reaction, isn't it? Blaming his wrongdoing on someone else. Allowing the weakness of another person to control his own life. And then God asked the woman. Oh, the woman said, "Is the devil." And now, who would the devil say is responsible? Apparently, the devil was even more responsible. And the two of them, because the devil had no one else to blame. But the last Adam was responsive. The last Adam responded with character. He didn't react when the devil came and said, "If you are the Son of God." He responded with character. He responded based on principle. He responded based on value. He said, "It is written." Principle. Character. Whereas the first Adam was reactive. The proactive focus on their strengths, deal with their weaknesses, rise above their adversities. The proactive focus on their circle of influence. They work on the things that they can do something about. And the number one thing you can do something about is you. They work on themselves instead of worrying about conditions. The reactive, on the other hand, focus their efforts on their circle of concern. They are so preoccupied by their concern. They focus on their weaknesses. and the weaknesses of others, the problems in the environment, the circumstances that are beyond their control. That is their focus. They are so preoccupied with circumstances that they have no control over. Their focus results in blaming and accusing attitudes, reactive language, and increased feeling of victimization. They have this feeling that they are being victimized. Everybody is victimizing them. The environment is victimizing them. Every day they are just victims. In Luke chapter 19, we know the story of the master who gave talents to his servants. To one, we are told he gave five. He gave three to another. He gave one to one, to one guy. And you know this guy, he didn't do anything with his talent. The first guy invested. He gained five more. The second invested. He gained. But this guy hid his own. And you know what he told the master when the master came back? Look at Luke 19:21. It says, "For I feared you, because you are an austere man. You collect what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow." The reactive servant focused on the weakness of the master and he failed. He focused on his own thinking, assumption of the weakness of the master. Now the master said, "Take a talent. You receive five, you take two." And then as far as he was concerned, the master had marginalized him. Why on earth will the master give five to this guy? What makes this guy different from him? Why did he give five to this, two to this, and just one to him? This man is not fair. How many times you have seen people that are not fair? The world itself is not fair. Life is not fair. Is life fair? No. We're just praying for some people who had everything going great, and all of a sudden doctors are saying something else. Is that fair?
No.
Oh, it's not fair. So life itself is not, the only one that is fair is God. Every other thing is not fair. And so when you now focus on fairness, you are wasting your time. And unfairness, as you focus on unfairness, it will be provoking reaction from you. You will not respond with answer. You will not respond with solution. Instead, you will be reacting. And then you now turn into a victim. And so the servant with one reacted and said, "No, master, it's not fair. What on earth? Why would this get fired?" And then what happened to him? He failed. And the master came and said, "Listen, take that one from him, throw him into the dungeon." He said, "Because even though you didn't want to invest, you should have, you wasted my time. Because from day one, I should have taken you away. Why did I leave you for this long?" Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Because the master said, "If you had kept my talent in the bank, it will have produced without you expending any effort. But because you didn't put it in the bank, you wasted my time." And that tells you that God is not interested in time wasters. God doesn't like time wasters. And he said, "Because you wasted time, throw him into the dungeon." He was a reactive servant. He was a reactive servant. If there's a problem, you know, because the reason why I'm going this tangent, because I know that one major area in the family is misunderstanding and conflict. Perhaps the greatest challenge to family life is conflict and misunderstanding. And we must know how to manage and resolve our conflicts and our misunderstanding. Now, a reactive husband, if there's a problem at home, a reactive husband will focus on the sins of the wife. He will say he's not responsible after all. And by saying that, he makes himself powerless. He makes himself a powerless victim. He immobilizes himself in a negative situation. And he reduces his ability to influence even his wife or to positively impact the situation. And then he begins to nag and accuse. He begins to demonstrate a critical attitude. And that, of course, the critical attitude of the man will validate even the sin of the woman. Because the woman will feel validated in the wrong that she's doing because of his critical attitude, because of his critical conduct. But a proactive husband will work on himself, on his own weaknesses, will take responsibility. He will not try to shape his wife. That's not your job. Your job is to shape yourself, not to shape the next guy. He will not try to shape up his wife. He will focus on being a source of unconditional love and support and trust that is why we feel the power of proactive example and respond in kind. But whether she does or not, the most positive way you can influence the situation is to work on yourself. That's the most positive way you can influence any situation. It's not by blaming the next person. It's not by trying to correct and to shape up the next person. It's to shape yourself up. That's the best way. Look at the story of Joseph. You know the story of Joseph. Joseph was very proactive. He didn't languish in self-pity as a servant in the house of Potiphar at the age of 17. Joseph did not even focus on the weaknesses of his brothers because his brothers were envious of him. But he did not even focus on that. He didn't even focus on the fact that his brothers were envious of him. He worked on himself. And within a short period, he became the master. He was running Potiphar's house. Eventually, when he was tempted, he stood his ground, isn't he? He responded by character, with character. He didn't react, he responded with character. He landed in the prison. And even in the prison, he remained proactive. And he became a leader, even in the prison. Until God came through for him, he didn't compromise. He refused to compromise his integrity. He didn't say, I'm being in prison unjustly. And because this is unjust, this is unfair, and then get a reactive conduct and attitude, that will keep him in prison longer than necessary. And that's the dilemma with many of us. Our attitude is holding us back longer than it is necessary. I'm talking about spiritual matters now. And that's why we must respond and stop reacting. We know the story of Ruth and Naomi. You know, Naomi was reactive. She could not rescue. She could not be rescued from the grip and experience of the past. As far as she was concerned, God had dealt very badly with her. The future was a hopeless one. So she was reactive. But Ruth was proactive. Ruth was responsive. She steadfastly held on to her values. She didn't wait to be told. She acted in faith. When they got back to Bethlehem, Ruth stood up and said to Naomi, I'm going to the field to see if I can glean. She took initiative. She took responsibility. She didn't just sit down and say, everybody knows I lost my husband. Nobody's even coming to greet me. Everybody's focused on Naomi. Nobody is even paying attention to me. Or maybe because I'm a foreigner. He didn't go into all of that. He took initiative. He took responsibility. He got up. Said, I'm going to see if I can glean in the field. And as she was going, God was directing her. And God directed her to the right field. And we know the rest of the story. We know the rest of the story. So Ruth was proactive. Naomi was reactive. The proactive approach to mistakes is to acknowledge them, correct and learn from them. So that they will have no power over the next moment. Because we live our lives in moments. And there are very defining moments. And that's why we must be proactive. Because it is not what others do, or even your own mistakes, that hurt you the most. What hurt you the most is not what others have done. It is not even the mistakes that you have made. It is your response to those things that hurt you the most. Everybody makes mistakes. Who is above mistake? Nobody. Only God is above mistakes. The best of anybody is the human being. As Samuel, as great a prophet as he was, he got into the house of Jesse, he got confused. He didn't know who the next king was. And this was a great prophet. So that shows you that as long as we're in this scheme, we are prone. But if your heart is right, God will direct you. And so it is not what others do, or even the mistakes that you make that hurt you the most. It is your response to those things. Because if a poisonous snake bites a person, what is this? What should the person do? Should the person carry a stick and be chasing the snake around to kill the snake, or try to stop the poison from traveling in the body? If a poisonous snake bites a person and you carry a stick and you are chasing the snake all over, the snake is dodging, you are chasing. Before long, the poison will travel to the wrong place and the snake will be watching you, you will knock down. But if snake bites a person, the first thing to do is to stop the flow of the poison. Forget about the snake. Stop the flow of the poison. Deal track yourself. Answer, respond with solution. Respond so that the poison does not travel the entire system. It is far better to take measures immediately to get the poison out instead of wanting to pray to kill the snake. So be proactive in resolving conflicts. Because I said earlier, a great challenge to marriage is learning how to manage conflicts, how to overcome our differences so that we can have harmony rather than discord in our homes. You see, understanding is very crucial. Understanding. And you see, understand is a combo of two words. Understand. Understand. That's understanding. Understand. What does it mean to stand under? To stand under is to do what? To humble yourself. Because if you don't humble yourself, you can't understand your spouse. If you think that you are, you know what cracked me up? When we were in high school, then we were in a class. There was this girl in our class that was always coming first. Many of us felt ashamed. We tried so hard, we couldn't do it. We couldn't beat her. And there was this guy that was always coming first from the rear. Do you know this guy coming first from the rear married this girl who was always Now imagine in that house. Imagine in that house. This guy coming first from the rear. He's not going to be thinking that he's smarter here. Oh, my wife said he's smart anyway. To have married this. And so when they talk about finance at home, this guy coming back. Who had F9 in maths? And this one with A1 in maths. F9 in maths will now try to control the maths at home. And try to make A1 in maths look like she doesn't know maths. She doesn't know anything. How do you think it goes? How will it go? Oh, of course. And so that's why sometimes you find some men who are always coming first from the rear, marrying girls who are always coming first from the rear position. And then these guys want to dominate these women. Just they want to do this. I'm the head. Oh, this head. You want to be careful with this head. He's F9 head. And you know, that is the irony of life, isn't it? And that's why there will always be misunderstanding. Because sometimes your position, you may not really have the IQ and the wisdom and everything to carry the position. And that's why God says, a man needs help. A man needs help, really. Yeah. Someone looked at Adam and said, this guy, he needs help. Because he sits as if he's ahead. And so the man must be able to understand. Stand under. I'm not saying in all cases. I'm saying in situations where your wife is more proficient than you. In areas where your wife is more proficient than you. Humble yourself. Because to understand is to stand. You won't, if you are not able to, if you don't want to humble yourself, you won't. You know, I see men ruining the finance of the home and saying, I'm the head. The wife is saying, this investment is not a right one. I'm the head. Until the money is thrown away. And I'm still the head. But this head is F-head. Praise the Lord. And so we must respond to conflicts well. Let me share with you very quickly the next 5 minutes some responses to conflicts in the scripture. Because you see, conflicts can be very good. The outcome of any conflict, whether good or bad, is determined by the way and manner that we resolve the conflict. Whether we react or we respond. If you react, it gets out of hand. If you respond, you come with an answer. You come with a solution. And by responding, you get to know one another the more. Because conflicts sometimes tend to bring into the open certain areas in our relationship that needs attention and correction. And so a healthy attitude is needed towards conflict, especially in the home. Now look at in 1 Kings 21, 2 to 4, it's the story of Ahab wanting to take the vineyard of Naboth. And Naboth said to Ahab, 1 Kings 21, 2 to 4. So Ahab spoke to Naboth, saying, "Give me your vineyard, that I may have it for a vegetable garden, because it is near, next to my house. And for it, I will give you a vineyard better than it. Or if it seems good to you, I will give you its worth in money." But Naboth said to Ahab, "The Lord forbid that I should give you the inheritance of my fathers. That I should give the inheritance of my fathers to you." Look at verse 4. So Ahab went into his house, solemn and displeased because of the word which Naboth the Jezreelite had spoken to him. For he has said, "I will not give you the inheritance of my fathers." And he lay down on his bed, turned away his face, and will eat no food. Can you relate with that? Can you, like a baby? I say, "Oh, you can't have that thought. Okay, I'm not eating. And I'm not going to go to school tomorrow." As if you go to school, you are going for your parents. If they give you a certificate, is it your parents that will use it to work? That is a king. That's a head. That's a head. Look at the way the Bible describes this head. The Bible says he laid down from verse 3, said, and he went to his house solemn, displeased. And then the Bible went for that. He went to lie down. He turned away his face. He wouldn't talk to anybody. And then he would not eat. How many men here? Your wife says no. In the night, you turn. She said, "No, don't touch me. You turn. I'm so tired." And then you squeeze your face and face the wall. And then in the morning, what do you want to eat? "I'm not hungry." "I'm not hungry." And then what is supposed to be nothing, before long, you blow it up. And then it blows up on your face. What shouldn't be a matter at all, you turn it into an issue. Like King Ahab. Ahab turned it into an issue. He refused to eat. He began to suck. Like a baby. He's a king. I hope you're not a king in your house like this guy. And look at the woman. Look at the wife, Jezebel. How Jezebel also reacted. And then we'll call it a day and pick it up another time. Look at 1 Kings 19. 1 to 2. 1 Kings 19, 1 to 2. Now for the women. I know men can squeeze their face and suck a lot. Look at 1 Kings 19, 1 to 2. "And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. Also how he had executed all the prophets from the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, 'So let the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time.'" Jezebel blew up. Jezebel did what? Went into a fit of rage. Went into a fit of rage and said, "I'm going to kill that guy. I'm going to kill him. If by tomorrow, I'm going to kill that guy." How many women are like that? Something happens at home. You just